Welcome, everyone. My name is Sonia, and I work as a technical account manager in Google. And today, we'll be talking about how to design your applications and make them more accessible. So before we start, let's have a show of hands for how many of you have created Android applications? Oh my god, awesome. Great. How many of you have tested these applications for accessibility? Okay, not too much. So hopefully after my talk today, you all will be inspired. Go back and see your application and make them more accessible, right? Yes? Okay. So let's get started. This is my agenda for today. We'll be talking about what exactly accessibility means, what are the features that are currently available in the framework and in different versions of Android, what is it that you need to do as a developer to make your application accessible, and finally, I'll wrap up with how do you test your applications and maybe some debugging tips. So accessibility is the degree by which you make your applications available to as many people as possible. This term is generally used for people who have special needs. For example, if you cannot see too well, or if you cannot see at all, or if you cannot hear too well, or if you cannot hear at all, or if you have motion impairment, and you cannot use maybe pointed devices like mouse, and you rely on keyboard, trackball, D-pad, etc. So, definitely accessibility is for these special needs, but then even as a person who may be able to see, hear, etc., you will not be using all the senses all the time, right? For example, if you're driving, you don't really look at the screen all the time, or if you are in a crowded area, you cannot hear too well. Just to illustrate this point, I use music application all the time. But the way I use this music application in the day versus the way I use it when I'm jogging, versus the way I use it when I'm sleeping is really different. At the daytime, I don't mind looking at all the curated list, all the album art, and then selecting the song that I want to listen to. But when I'm sleeping, I really don't want to look at the flashy screen, right? At that time, if I can use the same application and do some kind of gestures to maybe play, pause the music, or you know, just wave at the phone to maybe pause the music, that's great. Now, when I'm jogging, I cannot even do these gestures on the phone, and I obviously cannot look at the screen. So at that time, some actions like maybe tapping or double tapping on the phone will make the same application more usable to me. So it's the same user and the same application, but the way I'm using this at different times is different. So the idea is that we all have five senses, and we should create applications to try and give feedback to the user using all of these senses, whatever we can. So this is how it works in Android. In Android, there is a settings menu in which you have accessibility settings. And only when you turn on these accessibility settings, anything happens. Nothing happens until you turn them on. Once enabled, any user action, like maybe clicking, scrolling, or any other user action, or any system actions, like maybe opening a new window, or maybe going to the navigation screen, etc., all these start generating events. These are called accessibility events. These events are passed to services. In Android, we have a service called TalkBack, and the services give feedback to the user. So they give feedback to user in all possible ways. They will give spoken feedback. They will give audio cues. So like when you get a new email, you hear a sound, right? Those are audio cues. They will give vibrational feedback, which is called haptic effect. So TalkBack gives you feedback in all these ways. We are very committed to accessibility right from the beginning, and we have added new features and a lot of bug fixing in all the various versions of Android. We started it from 1.6 onwards. So prior to Ice Cream Sandwich, the main feature of accessibility was text-to-speech API. What that means is that when a user connects a phone and uses D-pad, keyboard, or trackball, then any element which is focusable will give the spoken feedback. So elements have to be focusable here. And you can also play around with this. You can have different accents. You can even increase the volume or maybe the speed by which the talk is spoken, or you can decrease it if you don't understand the language too well. There were a lot of other accessibility features, maybe few to mention are large text. So you can enable large text, and as the name suggests, it will improve or it will increase the size of the text. And this is great for people who have maybe visibility problems. And you can do other things like disable screen rotation and a lot of other features. Maybe for people who have motion impairity, like they cannot touch the screen very fast, so you can even increase the time in between your double tap. So that'll be helpful for motion impairity people. Now this has a problem, right? There were a lot of new devices coming which don't have any QWERTY keyboard. So these are like touch screen and they don't have any QWERTY keyboard or trackball. So we could obviously attach a USB keyboard or a Bluetooth keyboard and then still operate. But we wanted to do something better. So in Ice Cream Sandwich, we added something called as touch exploration. What this means is that when you touch on the device, then whatever is below your finger will provide the spoken feedback. Do you think there is any problem with this, with the touch exploration? So imagine I cannot see, and I'm just exploring on the phone, and whatever is below my finger is providing me the feedback. Is that enough? Will that make a user understand the application, or do you see any problems? Okay. So there are many problems with this, and to name one of it is, say your application is something like a student and marks. So you have students listed here and marks listed on the other side. Now I cannot see, and I'll touch maybe student A and then go and read marks of student B, right? Because they are not linked together, and obviously I'm just touch exploring. So it'll give me wrong feedback. So in this case, you want that somehow the student and marks should be combined together and should be spoken together. So this is now possible, and you can have view hierarchy. So the talkback service will try and understand your view hierarchy, and whatever components should be spoken together should be in one container. And based on the parent-child relationship, your talkback will provide you feedback. So luckily, we solved that issue. Now, are there any other problems? Jelly Bean tried to improve and add a lot of new features. And let's see what are the features. They added a concept of accessibility focus. Accessibility focus is something like cursor because you can move it around all of your screen. And it is provided by the system to each and every view element. So remember I said that you have to make your elements focusable. And only if an element is focusable, it'll provide the spoken feedback. Now going forward, you don't have to even do that. The system will provide accessibility focus on all the view elements, and so everybody will, all the system elements will start providing accessibility generated events. You can see a yellow rectangle. That shows that this is the current element which is focusable. And all the accessibility events are then broadcasted to all the services. So we already talked about a service called TalkBack. We added another service called BrailleBack. What this means is you can now add a braille device and you can use it as input and output device. This is great for people who cannot see and they use braille device in their normal day-to-day life. Another feature which we added is accessibility actions. So accessibility focus is great, but then for all the focusable elements, you are actually doing some kind of actions, right? Like you're clicking on a button, or you're clicking something to maybe launch it, or maybe you're scrolling views, or when you want to listen to whatever is on the screen, you may want to read it as a whole paragraph, or you want to read it line by line, or maybe word by word, especially if you cannot see. So you're relying on the hearing feedback. So you can do all these actions, and also global actions, like going back, going to the home screen, or navigation screen. And all these are called accessibility actions. This is one of my favorite features in Android, that you can do all these accessibility actions using gestures without writing a single piece of code. You just enable explore by touch, and the gestures come by default. So you can do simple things like just swipe right, swipe left to go to the previous and back elements. You can do some L-shaped gestures to go to the home screen, and you can do a lot of other gestures to go to maybe the navigation screen, etc. The list of all the gestures is available in the developer site, so maybe go ahead and look at it. And you can also change how this mapping is done. So if you don't want to do a L-shaped gesture and you want to do something else, then there is a way to change it. This adds a very big benefit, which or basically solves a big problem which touch exploration has. Can you guess what? The hint is actually on the screen.
Scrolling.
What is that?
Scrolling.
Sorry, I cannot hear you.
Scrolling.
Scrolling?
Yeah.
No. So the hint is there. It allows you to deterministically go and see all the elements. So I'll give you an example to understand this. Say you have a big screen, and in your application, you just have one small icon somewhere. So as a user who cannot see, you will be touching the whole screen and then trying to figure out, like, where is that icon, right? You may think that there is nothing available on the screen and your app does not have anything. So that's a very big problem. If you can see, then you can obviously go and click on that small button somewhere on the screen. But if you cannot see, you can still use gestures, and all you do is somewhere on the screen, you just swipe right, and then it'll automatically go to that particular icon. So all you're doing is you're just doing swipe right, swipe right, swipe right, and it's deterministically going from one focusable element to another focusable element to another one. So you don't have to know where your icons are. Similarly, for launching it, you just have to click anywhere on the screen. You hear this spoken feedback, and then if you think that, yes, this is the right icon which I want to launch, you just click anywhere on the screen, and it launches it. So gestures not only good for like making it easier for sighted user, it's definitely great for people who cannot see. We also added magnification. This is available only from version 4.2 onwards. So large text is already there, but you can increase the size much more by doing magnification. And all you have to do is triple tap on the screen and it'll zoom. And then you can work on the phone exactly how you will work in a normal state. You can triple tap again to go back to your normal state. If you want to zoom only for some time, then you can just triple tap and hold, and then you can see or pan around the screen, and then as soon as you lift your finger, it'll go back to your normal state. And this is maybe the last feature that I'm showing. It's called Global Shortcut. So you can always go to Settings, Accessibility, and then enable whatever you want to enable. But there is a shortcut for it. You can just do an L-shaped gesture and tap, and then you can just pause and suspend talkback easily just by one swipe. You can repeat whatever was spoken before just by one swipe, and you can also spell it. So to understand all this better, let's see a very quick demo. Just give me a minute. Okay. So how I enable accessibility is just go to the settings menu and then go to accessibility. And you can see that there are a lot of other features which I haven't talked about, but you can always play around and see, like you can enable power button to end a call, or you can even speak passwords. Not a great feature, but it's great for people who cannot see and sometimes useful. So the ones which I want to show you was magnification. If I turn it on, now if I triple tap, it does not understand. It zooms, right? So I just triple tap on the phone and it zooms, and I triple tap so that it goes back. Sorry, I think. It does not like my finger touch. Okay, that's bad. So it goes back to the normal screen. And then once more, I'll triple tap and hold, and hopefully it'll work. And no. So I just triple tap and hold, and I can pan around the whole screen. And as soon as I lift my finger, it'll go back to the normal state. So that's magnification. And let me show you TalkBack. So TalkBack, as we discussed, is the screen reader for the Android phones. And as soon as I turn it on, it'll start speaking. It shows you a scary dialog box, basically telling that it'll interact with your activities and understand what's in your application. And obviously, it has to do that so that it can, you know, listen to the accessibility actions. So let's say OK to this. So if you see now, anywhere I swipe on the screen, and you see that the focus automatically went to the first one, TalkBack, which is showing a yellow rectangle, right? I swipe again,
box checked.
It went to the next element. So I don't really have to know where the button is. I'm just doing a simple swipe, and it's automatically going to the next button, etc. If I swipe again, it'll start reading this.
List showing one items. When TalkBack is on, your device
Saw this awesome feature? I just waved on the phone, and it's using proximity sensor, and the TalkBack stopped speaking.
Settings.
Now it's again going to the next button, settings, and I don't have to know where it is. I can click anywhere.
List showing one item. Settings.
To basically launch it.
List showing one item. Settings. List showing one items. When TalkBack is on.
I can do some simple gestures, like L-shaped gesture to go back.
Showing
go back.
Settings.
Go back.
Home.
So now on the home screen, again, wherever I touch, whatever is below my finger will speak. And you'll see a lot of Berlin-based applications, because I wanted to know about Berlin.
14, Berlin. Play Store. Home. Access Berlin.
So it's just speaking whatever applications are on my phone. And the last feature that I wanted to show was the global shortcut menu. So you just do a L-shaped gesture and tap, and you get this great shortcut menu.
Then lift to select.
And I can make it speak whatever is the last spoken word.
Berlin.
And I can even spell it.
Capital B-E-R-L-I-N.
And I can suspend TalkBack.
Suspend TalkBack. Okay button.
So TalkBack is now suspended, and if you see now when I'm touching, it's not speaking anything because TalkBack is suspended, and you can see that from the navigation bar. It's saying TalkBack is suspended. So that's our demo, and let's go back to what else the framework provides. So it's not only about what's in accessibility settings, right? Like Android framework provides a lot of other features that you can use in your applications. For example, you have SMS, video chats, Hangouts, which are great for people who cannot see. Again, you have a lot of location-aware GPS, places, maps, which are great for people who don't have very good direction sense or if they are coming to a new place. You already saw an example of proximity sensor. You can also use this in your applications. Maybe, you know, stop music by just waving at the phone, etc. You have a lot of ice-free sensors, like you have motion sensors, accelerometers, velocity trackers, etc. So motion sensor you can use to maybe do actions like tap, double tap. You can use velocity tracker to do things like swipe actions. You can use light sensor in your application, so you know how much light is falling on the device, and based on it, you can maybe change the theme of your application or maybe make it more brighter, etc. So Android provides a lot of motion environmental sensors, and the way you use it totally depends on your own creativity. But there's a lot of code examples available. There's a lot of like open code available, so you should definitely use it. You all must be knowing about the developer console, right? Since you all have published applications. Let me ask you a question. How many of you speak more than two languages? More than three? Not too many, right? So you'll be amazed that only 30% of people speak English. And if you want to reach out to the rest of 70% of people, then you should localize your applications. And maybe you should target different countries and regions. So, of course, Google Play allows it. You can have paid applications in nearly 135 different countries and regions. And if you have published your application, then you know that in the console, you can actually specify which countries you want to target. You can select all the countries, or you can choose some specific countries. Have you used the auto-translate feature? Has anybody used it? Great. So say I want to target Germany, And I have no idea about the German language, but I still want that people in Germany should see the application in German language. Then I can do that without knowing the language. All I have to do is that in the console where I'm publishing the application, I will just select auto translate button and specify the countries that I'm selecting. So it'll auto translate, and in Germany, it'll show it in the German language. You can launch it in different countries, and then you can see the statistics. So you can see how your application is doing in different countries and regions, and then maybe use, you know, the standard libraries like I18N and L10N, so that you can internationalize your application. And this is the last framework feature that I wanted to tell. So most of us, when we create application, we like bother about the look and feel of the application, right? We want that in some way, we want to differentiate our application from other similar application. So look and feel is obviously great, but it's very, very important to have the functionality intact and also some kind of standard ways. Like, you don't want the user to learn new things. You want that, yes, back button works like a back button. So you don't really want to use different things there. So the design recommendations which Android provides is great, and it also has a lot of things from accessibility point of view. It gives you the following four guidelines which are specific for accessibility. These are the recommendations, and you can always choose to like do it or not do it, but you should definitely read these recommendations and then decide for yourself. So the first one is that the navigation should be easy. It's very simple whether you want to think about accessibility or not, that anything which is very important, the user should be effortlessly reaching that thing by maybe doing one swipe or one click, right? So the navigation for major things should be really simple. The design recommendation guide also talks about various font size colors that you should use. So you can always use those. And the widget sizes, etc., are defined there. Has anybody used the fade out controls or know what fade out controls are? You all must have seen the toast message that's there for some time and then goes away, right? Or if you have used music application, you will see the fade out control of play, pause, that button. It's there for some time and then it goes away. So these fade out controls look good, but then if I cannot see, then obviously I might miss out some things. So it's very important that if you are using fade out controls, that you have some way of alternative ways of telling or give spoken feedback to the people who cannot see. And this, the last one, is the most important thing, that you have to label all your elements properly. You have to give meaningful labels to all your UI elements. Whatever labels you are providing to your UI elements are the ones that will give the spoken feedback. So it's really, really the most important thing. For things that change state, for example, like you have play button, and when the user clicks on it, it becomes pause button, right? So you have to change the label accordingly. Similarly, you have to make sure that you don't provide too much of feedback. So for example, you just have album arts on music application, and you don't really want anything to be spoken for album arts, right? Because there's no really meaning in those album arts. It's only for the look of it. So don't provide any labels for these decorative images. So labeling is really the most important thing. Great. With this, we covered what's available in the Android framework. And now we come to a little more interesting part, which is that what should you do as a developer to make your application accessible? Before we start, I wanted to show you a demo of a bad application, a good application, and then what kind of code you write for it. So let's see a quick demo.
Oh. Gallery. Accessibility demo. Accessibility demo launcher. Showing items 1. Content descriptions in a. Inaccessible.
So this is one of the application. Most of the standard applications will have some kind of buttons, images, text boxes, edit boxes, etc. Now, as a sighted user, you can see that, okay, there is something to search. There is some kind of an edit box. There is some map and maybe some people. But still, even as a sighted user, you really cannot make out what this application is doing, right? Now think about a person who cannot see and how they use this application. So you will touch it.
Edit box.
edit box.
Double tap to enter text.
They have no idea like what should they enter, right? It's just saying edit box. They go a little more.
Image 51.
So they have no clue, like what is it?
Image 12.
So this is really, really bad example, and you should not do this. And if you don't think about accessibility, then this is how the application will be for a person who cannot see. So let's see example of a good one.
Accessibility demo launch. Content descriptions fixed.
So this is a fixed one. Now, even for a sighted user, you can see that there is some kind of a hint. It says search for deals. So even as a sighted user, I know that, okay, this is some kind of a deals application. Now, if I cannot see and then I explore it.
Edit box, search for deals.
Great, right? So even as a, even if I can't see, I know that, okay, this is some kind of an edit box and it is searching for deals. So you have to type something which will search for deals. I go down.
Local deals.
It's saying, okay, local deals. So I know that when I click on it, it'll be some kind of local deals.
Social deals.
Social deals, etc. So this is some kind of a meaningful feedback for the same application and makes it more accessible.
Accessibility demo launcher.
So what do you do as a developer to make this a little more accessible or to have the fixed one? Let's see the code. So this is pretty simple, right? You just added meaningful labels, and that is what you need to do as a developer. So as a developer, you know about the layouts. And in layout, you can add something as Android content description. So all you're doing is you're adding a content description for each and every element where you want the spoken feedback. Now, there are a lot of tools available which can find out whether you have missed a label. I don't know if you have used lint tool. If you have not, then you should definitely use it. So lint tool will give you warnings wherever you have missed mentioning about the label. So you should run that lint tool. And just so that the lint tool does not give you a warning, even for the decorative images, you should add content description, but you should maybe mark it as null. So sometimes you remember I gave an example of play application where the play button becomes pause button when the user clicks on it. So basically it's changing dynamically and you can add it in code by doing set description or get content description. Just a hint here that get content description has some kind of a caching issues, so always use set content description. So that's like a programmer hint. Now, in case of edit text box, it's not only the visual, it's also the visual feedback, right? You saw that even for sighted user, it gave you a hint. It's not only the audio feedback. So there you're using Android colon hint in your layout. This is how the code looks. It's very simple. For each of these elements, you can see that I've added Android content description as null for images because you don't want any spoken feedback. Android content description as some kind of a string for other image view where I want some kind of a spoken feedback. And for edit text box, I added Android colon hint. Now, this is great for ice cream sandwich and above, but if your application has to work from pre to the prior versions where the user is using keyboard, D-pad, and trackball, then remember you have to make it focusable on your own. Each element is not focusable by default, so you have to make it focusable. And you also have to care about the traversal order. So if you want that the user clicks on element A, and then when he presses next, it should go to element B, presses next, it goes to element C, then you have to care about this traversal order. There is a default traversal order, but it's better to not rely on the default one. So what do you do for that? All you need to do is make Android colon focusable as true. Really simple. So in your layout, you will just make the focusable element as true. And you will use some APIs like next focus down, next focus up, next focus right, next focus left to go to whatever traversal order you want to follow. So in code, it'll be like this. This is a simple layout where you have edit text and text view. For both, I have made Android focusable as true. And when you press edit text box and you press down, so next focus down will be your text view. So I have used those APIs. Another thing for which I don't have a code example to show, but it's really simple. You saw large text, right? So when you enable large text, you hope that all your application text will become larger in size. It will not work if you have not, if you are using dips and not scale pixel. Now, mostly in the layouts, we always use dips, right? And dips is great. I hope everybody knows dips as device independent pixels. But for the text size, you should use scale pixel. So you should do something called as Android text size equal to whatever number in scale pixel, SP. This is really, really very important because otherwise your large text will not work. And whenever you do this, you should make sure to test it. So if you are supporting different languages, change your language and test by enabling large text, because different languages, the string size will become different. From English to German, if you translate, the German size will make it 1.5 times larger, right? So you have to see that the text gets scrolled correctly. Now, by default, your container is not scrollable. So the text will actually get cropped when you enable large text. So make sure to make your container scrollable. This is, again, a developer hint which you should care about. Great. Now, you will think we did everything, right? We added labels, we made it focusable, and we have taken care of the large text. Is there anything else that we talked about which we are not seeing how we should do as a developer? You remember the problem that I mentioned about the touch screen? Let's see a demo.
247 Accessibility Demo Launcher. Item grouping inaccessible.
So this application looks perfect, right? You can see that, okay, from is from the credit card. It's some kind of a deal application. The date is related to the actual date. Status is related to the actual status, etc. So this is for a person, sighted user, it makes sense, right? But then if you cannot see, you really don't know, like, these, there is a row and these are linked elements. So you will just start exploring.
Transaction details. Amount, date, status, August, credit, August.
So do you understand the problem? Like,
45 cents US.
You cannot relate that the date is mentioned there because you are just clicking anywhere on the screen and you don't know that there are related elements, right? You want that whenever the user clicks on from, it should speak from as well as from wherever it is, right? These two are related and should be spoken together. Otherwise, the user will not understand. He'll just read
completed
and some number. So no idea about what is completed, etc. So these two should be grouped together because they are logically tied together. So in code, you have to tie them together and have it done in the view hierarchy. So let's see a fixed example.
Accessibility, item grouping fixed.
So here, if I touch.
From credit card, date, August 2nd, 20, stat amount, 120.
So you see that I'm clicking anywhere on the row, it's reading both the elements together because these are supposed to be spoken together. So let's see how we do this in the code. Okay. So the logic is like really simple. You have your layout and you have parents and child relationship, right? You have a parent element and then in between the child element. If the parent element is focusable and has content, then you ignore the child elements. If parent element does not have content description, then you will go ahead and read the child element content description. So Android provides something called as hierarchy viewer, which will basically show your layout in a graphical way like this. So this is a very simple example of your folder icon. And as you can see, the folder icon is your focusable element, and it has two child elements, image view and bubble text view. So like I explained, if the parent element has content description, then just read that. So this is how the code will look. So in the code, your first element has content description as well as the child elements have content description. So I want you guys to guess, smile. Okay. So here's an example, and I want you to guess what will be the spoken feedback based on my theory. So the way I generally remember it, like if you go into somebody's house, right? If you like the parents are interesting, then you can ignore the kids. If the parents are not interesting, then you actually go and like mostly talk to the kids. So can you understand, like?
Screen off, ringer 50.
This is just the way I remember it, but like. So here, if the parent has content description, speak that and that's it. Forget the kids. If the parent does not have content description, only then go and see what's there in the kids. So here you see that the folder icon, the parent has a content description, so it'll only speak folder Google and nothing else. Right?
2:52 p.m. Screen off, ring.
So I'm sorry, I think the time is over. I had more examples, but maybe I'll just summarize. And the slides are there, so please go ahead and see. Yeah, just to summarize, like if you are using Android components, then these are the only five things you have to do. You have to label your controls, make them focusable, make sure the traversal order is correct, specify the text in SP, and then logically group them. We saw examples of all of these. I'm not able to show you examples for custom component, but if you're interested, I'll be there available outside. So please feel free to come and talk to me. And yeah, I have a good to have list that provide feedback, et cetera, but I think we're running out of time. Henrik is hinting me that it's already time is over. So please go ahead and read it. Thank you very much. And please let me know if you have any questions.
Thank you, Sonia.